First of all, thank you all for coming to hear the talk. Thank you to our sponsors, our organizers, SDX, for the venue, Pixelania, Platform SH, NIE, Acquia, Sepalsa, and Dober. I'm Pavlos. I work here at SDX. The person responsible for taking care of our CMS, that as you probably can guess, is built in Drupal. It can be found on Drupal.org and the following Slack channels, the general Drupal Slack, the Vancouver Drupal user group, and the recently made Drupal SG. It's my LinkedIn and Twitter if you want to connect. A few things about myself. I started doing Drupal about 8 years ago. I graduated right in the midst of the financial crisis. So what I graduated from and where I ended up is two very different things. At the time, someone suggested, as I was looking for a job, someone suggested, why don't you build a website for yourself? Try to promote yourself. So that guy was into Drupal, so naturally he suggested Drupal. And I built one, and the rest, as you say, is history. What we will go through today, we will briefly touch on headless decouple Drupal. We will see how GraphQL compares versus normal REST. We will touch base on the GraphQL module. We will check out what the GraphQL Explorer is. What are persisted queries or in the Drupalism that we have, what are query maps? And if we have time at the end, we will look at some examples. So practically everyone here right now heard of decoupled Drupal and headless Drupal. Here at SGX, we have a lot of web applications. All these web applications 1 year ago were drawing from their own systems for their content. So if an author had to write an article for the mobile application, they had to go to the application that supported the our mobile app. If they wanted to write the same article for the website, they had to do it again through their website CMS, and there are other applications that wanted to use this content, but there was no way for them to do that. So naturally, we wanted to consolidate all of these into one system. We didn't want the author to have to write the same article a lot of times, and maybe they would make errors. We'll need to check that article over and over again. So we ended up with wanting to do a content repository system. And the CMS of choice at that point was Drupal. We also wanted the, as the slide says, free the front end. Our front end, there's a specialized in JavaScript. They have no idea what Twig is. They are not interested in writing any Twig templates. They know their JavaScript well. They can write their HTML, they can write their CSS, and they're happy. So what we need to do is just provide them the JSON feed of our content. They can consume it, they can display it however they want for whichever application they want. Also, this is future proof. If tomorrow our frontend developers decide they want to scrap the entire frontend framework that they use and go for React, we don't care. It's totally up to them to do whatever they want. So, how does GraphQL compare with REST? Because we did explore initially various modules to achieve this. We went through the Drupal core REST, we went through JSON API, which at that point in time was then that fleshed out yet. We looked at exporting just a JSON through views, but we ended up in to GraphQL for two main reasons. One reason was that the front end just wanted to do one query or one call to the endpoint and fetch the entire page. With a normal REST, especially with a pure RESTful API, we couldn't do that. We would have to fetch the page or the node, then go through all the references and fetch all of those one by one until we can build our page. With GraphQL, we can just do one query and fetch the entire page. That's particularly the case for us because we are using paragraphs extensively. And as you know, paragraphs are NTD references. So that would be a lot of round trips to the server just to build a page. You can achieve the same thing with JSON API right now using the subrequest module. But for us at the time, GraphQL was the way to go. What is GraphQL? GraphQL is based on a schema. It is self-documenting, and it's meant to empower the consumer instead of rigidly defining on the backend how your APIs are, what your APIs give. So we don't worry about, oh, I built this API, but now the mobile applications need to consume it. But the mobile app doesn't need as many fields as the website does. Do I need to build a new API? No. I just let my mobile app talk to my GraphQL endpoint, and they request only the fields they want. They don't need to get any more than exactly what they need. So how does a GraphQL query look like? Let me know if that slide is not very visible. But the GraphQL query basically consists of fields like our title, our type. It consists of arguments like in this case, what type of node I want to bring in. It consists of operations like the node query. So in this example we have right here, we're going through building a node list basically consisting of the content type called page. It consists of directives, which unfortunately I don't have an example of here. So a directive is a way to manipulate your query on the fly. So you could have an if statement in the query where you could check one of the variables passed in, and then if that variable existed, you could add more items to your query. We have our fragments, which in this case is our page fragment at the bottom. These are used kind of like a switch statement would be used. So on our entities field there, our entity can be a page, it can be a landing page, it can be an index if we so wish. Any content type that you may have on the site could fill in that place there. So we don't want to keep writing all these fields that we need to fetch every time we want to call the page content type. So we define our fragment and we just pass it in. What else is special for this query? So the GraphQL module. Development is done on GitHub. It is predominantly maintained by two guys working for Amazy. The current version is beta 7, I believe. It could have been created. There's a very good example implementation on GitHub. Documentation is not the best, but it has come a long way since we started using the module. It's based on the Webonix library, and it comes with two modules out of the box. The GraphQL module, which provides the integration between Drupal and Webonix, and the GraphQL core, which is an automated schema generator for your Drupal website. When you install GraphQL core, your entire Drupal site becomes available through your GraphQL endpoint, basically. That may sound a bit scary, but don't worry, because the module does adhere to the entire permissioning system of Drupal. So if you request the nodes from the GraphQL endpoint as an anonymous user, you will only see what you have permissions to see. Nothing more, nothing less. And it uses Drupal Core's type data API to define that schema. The GraphQL Explorer. This is where you will do most of your debugging in the query, for the queries. So this is a very simple query to fetch in my home page with its header. As you can see, I am passing in the path, the language. The key things to note here is the entity URL fragment, which basically tells the query if the path that I've given you resolves to an entity, then fetch me that entity. And through that, we go and say, is that entity a landing page? Yes, then bring me these exact fields. Nothing more, nothing less. Your documentation is right here on the left, on the right-hand side. As we said, our GraphQL is fully self-documented, so anything that is available to you, you can see and debug here. You can see your history, you can define the variables. And this is how you can test your queries quickly, prototype them, and see how they work. A few notes here. This does post request to the GraphQL endpoint. GraphQL doesn't just do post, it can do get. So you could serialize this entire query and pass it in a get request in the query variable. Most people think that GraphQL just would post because of some either server limitations or browser limitations that impose a length limit to your get request. We can get around that by using persistent queries. So persistent queries not only allows you to execute as whatever get request you want without worrying about any variable limits that the browsers or the servers may have, but they also allow you to lock down your API. So a front-end client will never be able to do a query that you haven't allowed through your query map. So if we go back to our GraphQL module, there's two ways the GraphQL module discovers the query map. You could either define a directory somewhere on your server where all the query maps get uploaded, or you can upload them straight into Drupal as a configuration entity. I choose to do it this way because I can export it and version control it through Drupal's config system. Also because even though the frontend likes the power of defining their own query maps, we kind of restrict them on what they are able to do. So we still want to maintain some control, and pretty much is the way we do it. As you can see, these query maps are hashed. So the hash here is the version of each query map. What that means is that the module basically serializes the entire query map file. It hashes it, and that's your version. So anytime you do a change, your version gets updated. If I inspect my query map, I can see what operations this query map allows. I can get, for example, my page. This query works for any page on the site. I have fragments in there that can be landing pages, basic pages, or article pages. So we can throw anything, any node page and node path in this query, and it will return something. We can return the menus because we cache those separate from the page. We have a query to bring our taxonomy terms, our index list, and so on and so forth. So if an operation is not defined in this query map, the front end cannot execute it. They will get a 403. If we didn't have that, honestly, our security team would have made it. Anyone out there, because our APIs are public APIs, could just issue query after query to the server with no limits or huge limits, then basically do a denial of service attack on our website. So this is one way to avoid that. For the future, we want to move on to having authentication on our site. As I said, all our APIs right now are public, but we're bringing in applications that require privileged content. So we're looking about how to bring in OAuth2 or JW tokens to help us with that. And we will want to eventually start doing mutations. So mutations is how you do a post in GraphQL. If you want to create a node, you need to do your own mutation. Now, out of the box, the GraphQL module just gives you the API to achieve that. You still need to write your own mutations for anything that you may want to bring in. Also, all those query maps I've shown so far, they're just consumed by the website. We want to move into a space where we have one query map per application, and for that we're looking to contributing a module back to the community on to better manage that list of query maps and their aliases, let's say, because a hash is not doesn't really tell you which application this query map is for. So the ecosystem so far, we've already seen the GraphQL core module. There's GraphQL automated persisted queries module. What this does is it allows the frontend to define its own queries, and when they get posted or sent to the, or rather requested from Drupal, if they don't exist, they will get created. Obviously, again, this is something you will want to protect. Otherwise, anyone can start generating query maps on your site. We have the GraphQL meta tag module, which provides the integration between Drupal GraphQL and the meta tag module that we all know. We have the GraphQL redirect module, which allows for GraphQL, the query we had before for paths, it would allow that query to follow a redirect through to the node it will result. For the less adventurous of us, we have the GraphQL tweak, which just exposes the GraphQL, allows the GraphQL to be used through the tweet templating system if you want to do some progressive decoupling. And last but not least, we have the GraphQL views model, which allows you to define new queries based on views. So these could be used, let's say, in a scenario where there's you wanted to integrate with Search API in Solr, but there's no GraphQL Solr module yet, but you can use the GraphQL, because Search API has a good integration with views, you could use GraphQL views to go through them. Some resources that I've drawn from for this are here. Feel free to check them out. Please download the module, test it out, find bugs, help us get it to a stable release, and I'll make these slides available as well. Thank you. If you have any questions, do let me know. The module does have its own caching mechanism, and it's basically following the cache types of Drupal. I'm sure you can do that, yeah, but for now we're just utilizing Drupal's internal cache with nothing external, and it's working pretty well for us. The moment you, because it relies heavily on the cache tags, the moment you publish something like a node, or the moment you change a paragraph anywhere, that cache tag is used is expired, and we have the cache right now set to the maximum it can be set from Drupal 4, and we haven't seen any issues yet. There's nothing else, but all I have right now, I realize it was a shorter talk than I anticipated. So.